blessed to introduce our speaker today, and we're very honored to have the Her Excellency the Ambassador Nguyễn Phương Nga come to Cornell. This event is the result of the efforts of many people and organizations. I just want to publicly acknowledge Vietnam's permanent mission to the United Nations and all it has done to make this possible. The Vice Provost for International Affairs at Cornell, Mario Ainaudi Center for International Studies, the Berger Program of the Cornell Law School, the Repi Institute for Peace and Conflict Studies at Cornell, the Cornell Society for the Humanities, and the Departments of History, Government, and Asian Studies, who have all supported this event. And also, I really want to make a special note of appreciation to all of the graduate students who comprise this and have taken the initiative on this Voices on Vietnam Speakers series, which we've been benefiting from for a couple of years already. And this is certainly one of our greatest events. Ambassador Nguyễn Phương Nga comes with great credentials, and I want to just introduce her briefly. In the 1980s, she studied for 5 years at the Moscow State Institute of International Relations, where she obtained an MA degree. She also trained at the Ho Chi Minh National Academy of Politics and Public Administration. In 1988, she began her work in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in the Department of Information and Press. In 2003, she became the Director General of this department of the ministry. In 1995, she went to her first foreign posting at the Vietnamese Embassy in Bangkok, Thailand. And in 2004, she was posted to the Vietnamese Embassy in Belgium and Luxembourg and the Mission of Vietnam to the European Union in Brussels. Since 2014, she has been Ambassador Extraordinary and Plenipotentiary and the permanent representative of Vietnam to the United Nations. She's a frequent lecturer in many venues on international journalism and media management. So it's a great honor and pleasure that I present Ambassador Nguyễn Phương Nga.
Thank you very much. I would like to thank each and every of you for being here today. And also, I would like to thank Professor Keith Taylor for such an extraordinary introduction. I am enormously appreciative of it, and I'm very humbled by it. And it's my great pleasure to be here at Cornell University. And it's really a great pleasure and honor for me. And I want to thank the leaders of the university, the Office of the Vice Provost for International Relations, and also all the teachers and everyone who is involved in the preparations of these wonderful events for making it possible. And thank you for a very warm welcome. I have heard a lot of this extraordinary university with extraordinary people that is the dream of so many young students, including my daughter. And what really struck me today from the tours to the universities, the museum, the university's library, meetings with students, what's really struck me are what you are doing here. I just use the words of the directors of East Asia of the Center of East Asia Studies, that you are creating new knowledge for a more equitable, sustainable, and peaceful future. That is very much in line with what we are doing at the UN. And today I have been asked by our students here to brief you on Vietnam. I'm very grateful to the Voices on Vietnam speakers series for giving me such an excellent opportunity to share with you some information on our country, what Vietnam is today, what Vietnam is doing, and how Vietnam will be in the 21st century. So it's the topic of our discussion today, and this is also a very good chance for me to listen to you, to learn from you and to know what you expect from Vietnam. And within our time frame, of course, the topic is very broad, but I hope that you allow me to focus on some recent development in Vietnam and Vietnam foreign policy. And then I would welcome your comments and be ready to answer any questions you may have. I will try to be short, as I know so well from my experiences during the time I was the spokesperson of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, that the Q&A session is almost the most interesting one. Yes, so I will start with such a very brief overview on recent development in Vietnam. So you know our country so well, right? We are situated in Southeast Asia and in Indonesia Peninsula, a medium country, not so big, not so small, but we are very big in terms of population. And Vietnam embarked on the renovation, we call it đổi mới process, about 30 years ago. This year we celebrated exactly 30 years of renewal. And the 30 years of renewal represent the historical stage in the development of Vietnam. It is a profound, comprehensive transformation of our entire nation, of our entire people, with the goal of building a prosperous people, a strong nation, and a strong, democratic, equitable, and advanced country. And we have recorded great achievements. So Professor Keith Taylor witnessed himself from a less developed country, heavily ravaged by protracted wars. Vietnam got out of the socioeconomic crisis, became a low-level, still low-level, middle-income country, and shifted towards industrialization, modernization, and international integration. We have successfully implemented most of the MDGs, and I just give you some example. The poverty has been reduced significantly from nearly 60% in the 90s to less than 10% today. And per capita income is now more than $2,000. Maybe for you it's too small, but for us it's a great achievement. Over the past 5 years, as you know, the world and the region have seen complicated developments. The world economy has recovered, but still very slowly. And political crises have broken out in many areas in the world. Multi-dimensional competition has become increasingly intense, and especially among major powers. The situation in Southeast Asia, in East Sea, evolved in a very complex way. And all of that also exerted an adverse influence on our country. Inside the country, we also have our own problems. We had to face with the impact of the global financial crisis and economic slowdown, combined with inherent limitations and flaws of our own economy, shortcomings and weaknesses in leadership and management, which drove up high inflation, seriously affected the macroeconomic stability, growth rates, and population living standard. We also faced with heavy consequences of natural disasters, disease, and effects of the climate change. And against such a backdrop, we have just had the 12th National Congress of the Communist Party of Vietnam, and we have reviews of the process, and we came to a conclusion that even against that backdrop, our entire people have made all-out efforts to continue our renovation and recorded important achievement. The scale and the potential of the economy has been improved, and its macro level stability has been basically sustained. So we managed to keep the macroeconomic stability and inflation kept under control. Now I think that the inflation rate is around only 6 or 7%. There was a time when we had three-digit inflation in the past. And economic growth has been maintained at a reasonable rate of more than 5.5%. And ISA has become higher every year, with every year. And the social security has been better attended to and fundamentally ensured our people enjoy a higher living standard. The most important thing that we manage to keep social and political stability. Major and fundamental steps has been achieved in building a socialist, law-governed state of the people, by the people, and for the people. And in our policy, we always put the people at the center of all development strategies. Fundamental rights and freedoms of the people are respected and ensured. The 12th Party Congress has set the overall objective for our country over the next 5 years, which is to push forward the renovation in a very comprehensive manner, both economically and politically, to develop the economy fast and stable, and in a stable manner, sustainably, so that Vietnam could soon become an industrialized country. And we strive to meet some key targets. For example, average annual economic growth rate in 5 years would be 6.5% or 7%. And by the year of 2020, GDP per capita is around $3,000 to $3,500. And we aim at, you know, reducing the rate of poor household annually 1% to 1.5%. So it's very high objective for us, and we strive our best to fulfill those objectives. So that's the general overviews of our developments. And concerning the Vietnamese foreign policy, Vietnam's foreign policy has been always a policy of peace and friendship. After the establishment of the Democratic Republic of Vietnam in 1945, President Ho Chi Minh stressed the need to establish partnership and cooperation with other countries around the world. In his appeal to the UN in 1946, he said, and I quote, "With democratic countries, Vietnam is ready to implement the policy of openness and cooperation in all areas. Vietnam will cooperate with countries that are willing to cooperate with Vietnam in an honest and equal manner. And Vietnam is a friend to all democratic countries and does not create hatred or hostility against anyone." And his principle of peaceful dialogue has been really guidelines for our people throughout different periods of time. And the last 30 years witnessed the remarkable transformation in Vietnam's worldview from a framework of a global world divided into hostile camps, into a view of one global economy that offers opportunities and challenges to every state, including Vietnam. It's a very important shift in our mindset. And we rejected the zero-sum view of the world divided into friends and enemies, and we sought to become friends of all countries. And Vietnam set the stage for developing cooperation with all countries on both regional and global basis. And integration has been seen by us no longer viewed as a process of assimilation, but it's a process of interdependence. And we also, actually, what we have achieved in the field of foreign relations and the success we make in strategic adjustment nearly be very conducive to the maintaining, to the safeguarding of our sovereignty and national independence, and at the same time help us to broaden our foreign relations with other countries and to open Vietnam to foreign trade and investment and participating in a lot of international, both regional and multinational multilateral institutions. And we have now established diplomatic relations with 187 countries and we have trade and investment relations with more than 130 countries and territories. And by the end of 2015, we have established a network of 15 countries, the strategic partnership with 15 countries, and strategic partnership in given areas, especially in the areas of climate change, with 2 countries, and comprehensive partnership with 10 countries. And we are an active members of both regional and multilateral organizations like ASEAN, APEC, WTO, and ASEAN. At the regional level, we join ASEAN in our efforts to establish ASEAN community, and it already came into existence since the 31st December of 2015. And Vietnam also concluded a lot of FTAs. Yes, so we actually now we have already concluded 11 free trade agreements with a lot of countries. So I can name just a few very prominent ones. So we concluded TPP, yes, with 11 countries. We have the partnership and cooperation agreement and the Europe-Vietnam free trade area with European Union. We have FTAs with the Eurasian Economic Union, and we are also negotiating a series of more new FTAs. And if all of that concluded, Vietnam will be a member of a network of the most important trading partners, really 58 FTA partners all around the world. Yeah. So we already, you know, set up our objectives that we will continue to carry out the foreign policy of independence, send reliance, peace cooperation and development, multilateralization and diversification of our external relations, and comprehensive, proactive and active international integration, being a friend, a reliable partner and an active, responsible member of the world community. So that's a very brief, you know, overview of the Vietnamese foreign relations. Now I just want to tell you a few words about Vietnam and the UN. So you know so well that the UN was born out of the ashes of the Second World War II, right? And during the last several decades, the UN has grown to embrace 193 states to be the most representative global organization and to become the true center for coordination of global efforts to tackle common challenges. And we, even if we are very modest, we have to recognize that as a beacon of hope, the United Nations has indeed helped make the world a better place. Maybe not as what we expect, but we try a lot. By playing an increasingly important role in maintaining peace and stability, in protecting and promoting human rights, and advancing development and progress. Vietnam joined the UN in 1997, and we have always done our best to uphold the principles and purposes of the UN, and we actively participate in all activities of the UN across the three pillars. So peace and security, economic development, and social and human rights. Yeah. And in September 2015, you know that the world leaders have adopted a very, very important, very transformative agenda, that is the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development and the 17 Goals for sustainable development. Sustainable development. I have it here. It's 17 goals. Yeah. And now Vietnam is very much strongly committed to the implementation of the Agenda 2030 and the Development Goals and the SDGs. And Vietnam has participated in all the process of, you know, negotiating the agenda, negotiating the SDGs, and we also very actively now participating in the process of discussions of the long positioning of the UN, yes, to make the UN really relevant and really fit for purpose to help the countries implement the SDGs. And Vietnam is also considered a very good example of delivering as one. Maybe you know that we call it DOA, delivering as one. It's a model of working together in the UN. Yes, and we consider a very successful story. And we cooperated with the UN to be in one greenhouse in Vietnam, where every agencies of the UN working together under the same roof, sharing the same financial budget and also the information center. Yeah. And they work by the clusters, by the issues, not the vertically but horizontally. Yeah. And we also actively participate in the combat against climate change, in the process of the negotiations and also of the signing of the climate change accord, we call it Paris Accord. And very recently, we already deposited the instruments for ratification. So it shows very clearly Vietnam's commitment to the fight against climate change, which is considered like one of the great achievements of the Obama administration, right? And Vietnam has fulfilled its terms as an active member of Human Rights Council very recently. During the 3 years period of Vietnam participation membership in the Human Rights Council, we always upheld the principle of objectivity, transparency, and constructiveness, and equal treatment. And Vietnam also attaches great importance to and is ready to further the contribution to the maintenance of world peace and security. That's why we already participated in the peacekeeping operations of the UN. Still very modest, but we already have a few Vietnamese army officers to work in UN missions in South Sudan and also Central African Republic. And now we are planning to sell an engineering unit and level 2 hospital. Yeah. So now I will move on Vietnam and the Asia Pacific. Actually, you know, because Asia Pacific is a larger area, we belong to Asia Pacific as we are in the Southeast Asia. And our region, we are lucky to be in that region because Asia Pacific is experiencing recently unprecedented, far-reaching changes with its dynamic growth and increasing trend of cooperation and integration. Somehow we are proudly saying that the Asia-Pacific is locomotive and the engines of development of the world. Yes, for why? And actually, multilateralism, international law, peace, cooperation, and development are also the key elements to build a peaceful, stable, and prosperous Asia-Pacific. And regional countries are working to promote a lot of initiatives for political, economic, social, and cultural cooperation and integration, including new generations of free FTAs, yes, free trade areas, right? So you see here, well, we have the ASEAN community, and we have APEC, and you know that we are having very soon, in the next few days, the APEC summit in Peru. And Vietnam will be the host of the APEC 17, yes, in Hanoi next year. But of course, we're facing a lot of challenges as other parts of the world, so such as territorial and sovereignty disputes, maritime and aviation security, climate change, natural resources depletions, and disaster, natural disaster, epidemic, and extreme terrorism to some extent, cybersecurity, water security. And what caused deep concern for us lies with the territorial and sovereignty disputes, especially unilateral attempts to change the rule and to alter the status quo in South China Sea, in Vietnamese we call ISI, in defiance of international law. But for our region to thrive, peace and stability must come first. It is therefore of vital importance that peace and stability are maintained, maritime safety and security and freedom of navigation and overflight in the East Sea are secured. And Vietnam is working tirelessly with ASEAN members and all parties concerned towards that goal. And we call upon all parties to exercise utmost self-restraint, to refrain from the threat or use of force, to settle all disputes by peaceful means in accordance with international law, especially the UN Convention on the Law of the Seas, to fully respect legal and diplomatic processes. And we're also engaging with partners to ensure the full and effective implementation of the declaration of conduct of party in the South China Sea and work for the early conclusion of the code of conduct in the South China Sea. Yeah, that's what concerning the Asia Pacific. And I have a few words more on Vietnam and the US. Yes. So we are very delighted to see the robust development of Vietnam-US friendship and cooperation in the past years, particularly since the establishment of comprehensive partnership in July 2013. Actually, we share a lot of interests, and that became the driving force for us to overcome obstacles and differences, to make it possible that we came from old enemies to become friends and partners. Yeah. And in July last year, during the visit of our General Secretary of the party, the two sides adopted the joint vision statement. And last May, you know that President Obama just visited Vietnam. And our shared interests keep expanding as our cooperation and friendship grow at all bilateral, regional, and global level. Bilateral trade volume in 2015 reached $41.3 billion. Yeah, and we are expecting to have the trade volume this year around $50 billion. And the US is now ranking the second one among the trading partners of Vietnam. The first one is China. And currently, we have around 19,000 Vietnamese young students studying in the US. So few of them are in your university. And the US also has already lifted the lethal arms embargo against Vietnam. And the two sides also signed the joint vision on defense cooperation in 2015. So what I want to say here is our cooperation really expanded in all fields, from economic, yes, from political, diplomatic, to economic, trade, investment, and defense, and cultural and education as well. And now we have to realize the Vietnam-US joint vision statement and deepen our relations. We should build mutual confidence and trust. And we have enormous space to expand and deepen our cooperation in many areas of common interest. And we always, you know, attach great importance to the development of friendly relations with the US. Here I just want to tell once again that since the first days of our independence, President Ho Chi Minh wrote 14 letters to the then US President Truman and expressed the willingness to build a full cooperation partnership with the US. But somehow this was not taken into consideration and we missed a lot of opportunities. And you know, now we can succeed in building new relationships based on the convergence of interests and mutual trust. And we can join hands to be in a friendly long-term partnership for the benefits of our two countries and for peace and stability and development in the world and in the region. And I just want to tell you that, to cite a words from our General Secretary, why he met with the US friends here, that, you know, we we cannot change the past, but the future is in, it depends on us. So we can do a lot to improve improve the relations between our two countries. So just a few words of conclusions. Actually, the 21st century offers us a lot of opportunities, but together we have to face with a lot of challenges. In the past, so many people view, and you know, for many people, Vietnam was a war, and we do not want to have that image anymore. And we want the world to see us, to see Vietnam as a peaceful country with a dynamic and sustainable economy, a very reliable partner that makes active contribution to peace, stability, and development in the region and the world. So I stop here just to give time for Q&A. Thank you so much for your attention.